Open your Bibles, if you would, to Luke 5. That's where we'll be going first. Luke 5. Welcome. I am delighted that you are here. And this is my very first time to do a speaking, a Bible class, a Bible lesson live on Facebook. So we are live right now, welcoming in our friends. There's a couple of churches that want to feed it into their church, and we're playing with how to do that. And so tonight, we are going to continue on our path toward 1 Peter. But we won't be in 1 Peter tonight. We've got several detours we still want to make along the way. Last week, we spent the majority of our class time in Luke 24, the story on the road to Emmaus. After the resurrection of Jesus, leaving, and then this phrase, as we're cranking it into 1 Peter, the phrase that we are using is, we had hoped. And we talked a lot last week about that being a lowercase H hope. The people saying we had hoped that he was the prophet. We had hoped he was the one who would redeem us. We had hoped he was the one who would help us. And I ask you, was Jesus the one? Absolutely. Capital H Jesus introduces himself through Paul and through Peter later as the hope of glory. And Peter will call him in 1 Peter 1, the living hope, with a capital H. I love in the road to Emmaus, we talked briefly last time, I just want to do this as a bridge, briefly last time about Jesus on the road after he had talked to them, after he'd shared about himself, and when he sat down at the table with them in their home and broke bread. It says that Jesus opened their eyes. And it was the same phrasing used in Genesis 3:7, where as the consequence to original sin, the Lord opened their eyes to their sin and to their shame and to their nakedness. And then here in Luke 24, it says that Jesus opened their eyes to what? To himself. So in Luke 24, what we're going to call that is the reversal of the curse. We as believers, we as walking on dirt today, do not have to stare, somebody say truth, at our own sin and our shame and our nakedness before the Lord. But what do we stare at? The hope of glory, the living hope, where we're going, the end of the tunnel, the light of heaven, we stare into his face. N.T. Wright, who said the quote about the reversal of the curse, said this, listen to this quote. Jesus is revealed to us in the midst of life's journey with all its confusion. Somebody want to go, right there? Doesn't your past sometimes seem confusing? With all its confusion, hopelessness, and even despair. The revelation of Jesus comes through the Word, which completes and gives hope, capital H, hope to our stories. That revelation of Jesus comes also through worship, which includes the breaking of bread, the Lord's Supper. Could it be, I just posed this, could it be that what we have at the end of the road to Emmaus was the very first Lord's Supper after Jesus' resurrection, where he broke bread with them on Sunday, and he's telling them basically, remember. And is that not the theme of the Lord's Supper, of communion, that we continue to share in, remember who he is. Refocus your sights on heaven. Refocus your sights not on the hopes that we have, even though they can be powerful and good and feel so right, but can also be beaten and dashed, even the good ones. We focus our sights on the hope of glory, on his truth, and on his promises. Though it was night at the end of Luke 24, Cleopas and his companion, probably his wife, hurry back to Jerusalem to share their story that was made known in the breaking of the bread. We remember. See what you think about this statement. We become, yes, sisters, we become enthusiastic witnesses when Jesus becomes real in our own lives. Do you believe that? When you take on ownership and when your eyes have been opened to the hope of glory, no matter how dark it's been, no matter how desperate you've been, when our eyes, the eyes of our heart, become open to who Jesus is and his calling on our lives, we become enthusiastic witnesses to that. There is a story to tell. And 1 Peter is going to deal with this a lot. Peter's going to deal with this a lot. There's a story to tell when Jesus becomes real for us. There's a story to tell about us developing our faith. And so what I want us to do tonight is meet Peter. Now, some of you sitting in this room have been Christians and walking the road and know a lot more about Peter or know the same stories about Peter that I know. But what we're going to do tonight is be reminded of some stories about Peter as we hold hands and do a quick walk through the Gospels. As we remember in Matthew 4, Mark 1, and even in John 1, the story, the calling of Jesus to his disciples, to the original apostles, is made. And he says a couple of different things there. Come, he said. And then two places he says, follow me. And that's going to be so important when we talk next week about the end of the gospel. Follow me, Jesus says to Peter, looking at him. But we can always count on Luke to give us a few more details. So if you've got in Luke 5, if you opened your Bibles to Luke 5, that's where I want us to be for just a moment. Luke is the guy with the details. I am a nosy kind of girl, and I love the gospel told through Luke's eyes because he gives us more detail, more stuff about the girls, more stuff. They're always at table in Luke. They're eating constantly in Luke. A lot more about praising God is in Luke. That phrase is used. Carry right over into Acts, praising God. Luke breaks it down and tells us more and more detail. So here we've got a bigger story about the calling. Starting in 1. One day as Jesus was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, we call it the Sea of what? Galilee. The Sea of Galilee. With its people crowding around him and listening to the word of God, he saw at the water's edge two boats left there by the fishermen who were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, who was also who? Peter, who was also Peter, and he asked him to put it out a little from the shore. Then he sat down and he taught the people from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, put out into the deep water and let down the nets for a catch. Oh, but Simon answered, Master, we have worked hard all night and haven't caught anything, but because you say so, I will let down the nets. When they had done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. So they signaled their partners, they're motioning, come help us, in the other boat to come out and help them. And they came and they filled both boats so that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw this, he fell at Jesus' feet and said, go away from me, Lord, I'm a sinful man. For he and all his companions were astonished at the catch of fish they had taken. And so were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, Simon's partners. Then Jesus said to Simon, don't be afraid. From now on, you will catch men. And what that really means is you will capture alive. You will catch men while they are alive. So they pulled their boats up on shore, left everything, and followed him. And I love that scene. If we were doing strictly a worship class right now, we would begin with that scene. How when Peter begins to realize who Jesus is, his face hits the dirt. He grabs hold of Jesus' knees as he's going to the ground. He's holding on to him. And then he's saying, go away. Isn't that exactly what we do during our fallen love? Oh, Jesus, we love you. We want to hold you. Oh, Jesus, we're so unworthy to be with you. That's the movement that we experience, worshiping the Lord. We can't let you go. Stay with us. Oh, we can't even bear it. And here Peter does something, and I want to spotlight this for just a moment. He does something that is unlike what I would do. I believe that if this were me in this moment, I would be going, look at the fish. I can't believe this is going to be so much money. This is going to be so much food. My wife is going to be so proud of me. I'm going to be known as the fisherman now. Peter does not get so caught up, sister friends, in the blessing that he misses the blesser. He does not get so caught up in the blessing that he misses the one who blesses, that he misses the blesser. Mark 1, If you want to look there, feel free, but we're going to boot scoot right through. Mark 1, Jesus healed Peter's mother-in-law. Peter knew that Jesus could do these things. Hope was building. Now, if I were teaching first grade right now, I would be doing something like this. Boys and girls, do it with me. Hope was building. Can you feel the movement here? As these stories just add up and add up, you kind of got to do a drum roll. Hope is building here. The crescendo is coming. In Mark 5 and Luke 8, Jesus handpicks three of the boys. And he says, come with me. Watch what I'm going to do. And he takes this little girl who was dead, and he breathes life into her. We know resurrection is truth when Jesus is involved, right? Hope is building here. Peter is cranking it up, and he's staring into the face of the living hope, the hope of glory. And then the next big story we come to is where I want us to camp for a few minutes tonight. Matthew 14. Oh, I love this story, and I've loved it for a very long time. And this last week or two, getting ready to share it with you, I've become obsessed. Rick has looked at me some, and he's like, where are you? And I'm like, I'm in Matthew 14. I can't get this story out of my head. He's like, what about this story? I'm like, I don't know. There's something about this story, this season of my life, that is mesmerizing me. I don't know exactly what it is, and I'm not sure that I have the words to explain it. And tonight, I'm going to give it my very best shot with you. Matthew 14, what is it? Now, I want to set it up for you, because at the beginning of Matthew 14, Jesus finds out that his cousin, John the Baptist, has been beheaded. And we know in other accounts that was very upsetting for Jesus. And he wants to go away. It tells us in verse 13, he withdrew. But then crowds started following him. And so he fed them. He did what he does. And then again, in 22, we've got this precious scene. What did Peter know before this scene hit? He knew that Jesus is the one of abundance. Do you agree with that? With the abundance of fish. Jesus could do it. He knew that Jesus was the one who heals. He knew Jesus could do it. He knew that Jesus is the Lord of the resurrection. He knew Jesus could do it. And then we've got this story. And the first phrase caught my attention this time, different than it ever had before, as a woman walking a road of grief too. Listen to this. Immediately, people were fed. He says, I got to get out of here. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into a boat. Now, I don't know what he did to make them, and I don't know how they split up. All the fishermen in one boat and everybody else in another. I mean, this is a pretty eclectic group. And he's saying, you got to get in the boats and you got to give me a minute. Get in the boats. Go. Go. Immediately, Jesus made them get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side. While he dismissed the crowd, after he had dismissed them, Jesus went up on the mountainside by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves, because the wind was against it. What that phrase buffeted really means is it was being tormented. We know on the Sea of Galilee, storms can come up very, very quickly, just the positioning of it. Now, the writers in the gospel call it mountains. I do not call it mountains around the Sea of Galilee. They're basically kind of tall hills. But just the positioning of it sets the water up for this cyclone activity to come up rather suddenly. And so this horrible storm has happened, and Jesus is still praying. But for some reason, we think he can see it. He knows what's happening. During the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. It's a ghost, they cried out. They cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, take courage, "It is I. Don't be afraid." "Lord, if it's you," Peter replied, "tell me to come to you on the water." "Come," he said. I wonder if that was the same way Jesus spoke when he called him as an apostle. "Come, come." Peter had heard him say that before. "Come to me. Come. I want to be with you." Then Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid and began to sink. Cried out, "Lord, save me." And immediately Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You of little faith," he said, "why did you doubt?" And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshiped him, saying, truly you are the Son of God." When they had crossed over, they landed in Gennesaret, and then another story takes over that we'll pick back up in just a minute. They recognized that it was Jesus. Hours later, after saying, "Get in the boat," hours later, it caught Jesus' attention that there was a horrible storm. One of the things that caught my attention this week is one phrase that Mark uses. None of the other Gospels do. In Mark 6:48, it says this. Speaking of Jesus, he was about to pass them by. But when they saw him walking on the lake, they thought it was a ghost. Whoever gave Mark his information, now Mark was not an eyewitness here, but whoever gave Mark his information thought that Jesus was about to pass him by. Now some of you in the room know who was giving Mark the information to write the gospel. Peter. Have you ever felt like that, sisters? Have you ever felt like that? "I saw him. I saw Jesus. I saw his word. I saw what he said. I believed him to be truth. But it felt like, even for just a moment, who am I kidding? I know some of the stories of some of you in this room. It felt like for a whole season of life, or it felt like for a while, Jesus was passing him by. Jesus was going to walk right by if we hadn't got his attention. Now let's go back to the story. Jesus was walking right by. Mark got his info from Peter. But then Jesus speaks out while the storm is still raging. Jesus has not calmed the storm yet. While the storm is raging, Jesus says, "Take courage. It is I. Don't be afraid." Now, I've got to say this, and I'll say this as long as there's breath in my body. I picture myself saying this even on my deathbed. If you've heard me speak, you've heard me say it dozens of times. But I believe that one of the themes of Scripture is, do not be afraid, I'm with you. But sisters, we cannot mistake that. We cannot feel guilty in our fear, because fear is part of the human experience. True? We're going to feel afraid. So to me, what the command is, it's don't let your fear trump. Don't live a life of fear. When you feel fear, allow the presence of the Lord, the presence of hope, to enter in and to trump your fear. Expect your fear. Fear is to be expected. It is part of the human experience. As long as our bodies breathe air, we're going to feel it. But the presence of Jesus, just like in this story, don't be afraid. I'm here. Take courage. And then the next verses show such extreme bravery, I can hardly even stand it. As I close my eyes and I try to picture this story, the next scene absolutely blows me away. That one man out of those boys on these boats, that one man climbed out of the boat. Are you kidding me? While a storm is going on, it wasn't like, "Jesus, come get in the boat now. Just come on in, get out of the weather." I mean, Peter's like, "I want to walk with you. Teach me to do that. I want to be with you, Jesus. I want to be with you." The bravery that it took for him to do that. And then we see the touch of Jesus There's a picture I want to show you right now, and I saved this picture this summer getting ready for the study, and that is supposed to be the face of Jesus as Peter is underwater and he's reaching out his hand. I'll help you. How many times in my own grief journey have I said something like, I felt like the waves of the ocean just come over me suddenly. I'll be just walking along on the beach and all of a sudden I'm blindsided by a wave. But to look up and to hold out your hand and to know that Jesus is on top of the water. And girls, I really believe that one of the things we miss just reading the word of the Lord are the eyes of Jesus. His eyes weren't condemning Peter, oh, you of little faith. His eyes were so proud of Peter because of the story to tell and smiling, oh, you of little faith, come on. I'm so proud that you did that. Let me help you. And it says that Jesus caught him. Now, is that not a powerful image right there? It's not that he said, swim for your life, Peter, get back to the boat. I mean, Jesus caught him. Jesus caught him. Jesus caught him. Oh, you of little faith, which, by the way, I have to point out that Jesus never said to non-believers. Oh, ye of little faith was only said to people who believe. Oh, you of little faith, he wants us to have more. Jesus climbed in the boat and all was calm. And then we have this little phrase. At Jesus' birth, we know that he was worshiped. After the resurrection, we know that he was worshiped. But there's not many times in between that the word worship is used with Jesus, but this is one of them. They worshiped him here. They worshiped him. And again, the caution is, don't get so caught up in the blessing that we miss the one who blesses. That, sister friends, is where we find hope. That is where we find hope, in worshiping the one who blesses. In the stories of Jesus, it might surprise you to know there wasn't more worship than that. But you know what? On this side of resurrection, and on this side of Acts, and on this side of the beginning, I love at the very end of his life in Luke where Jesus says, if you don't worship, even the rocks will cry out. And may it be that for every woman in this room tonight and every woman listening online, may it be for us, that as long as there's breath in our bodies, we're not going to need a rock close to us to cry out. We're going to be bragging on him. You're going to teach your children to brag on him. This is a generational teaching to worship the Lord Jesus. Do you agree with that? We're going to worship him. We're going to worship him when things are good. We're going to worship him in the depths of despair when we have no clue what he's doing. Because he is the living hope. He is the one. And so as I prayed and I prayed and I prayed, I just had this moment this week that I woke up and these next five phrases I'm going to give to you, I feel like they're just like gift wrap from the Lord. I could not, when I woke up one morning, I could not write these fast enough. And I so hope I've written them well that they make sense to you. Listen to this. I want, Beverly Ross, I want to be looking for hope, capital H, when I am terrified. Don't you know that when those boys were in that boat, I picture it. Now, this is just me, okay? I picture them hanging on for dear life, looking over the edge, going, I think there's somebody on the water. Nuh-uh, there is. I think there's somebody on the water. And they're kind of looking out, going, are you kidding? Who is that? When we are terrified, may the eyes of our heart, as in Luke 24, the reverse of the curse, may we be looking for hope. Faith, I don't remember who I got this from. I did not write this next sentence. I don't remember. This is a quote in my Bible, and I don't remember where I got it. Faith is a mindset that expects God to act. Even as I say that, I feel like I've got to do a little tag here. I always get nervous when I go to speak that I haven't written in my notes, or I'm not sure that I want to say this, but now I've started, I guess I have to kind of say it, huh? Faith is a mindset that expects God to act. Now, can I tell you, for February 2010, I expected God to act. And I expected my daughter to be totally healed. And I expected us to have a ministry together where Jenny, I would wheel her at the time her legs were amputated. I expected to be able to wheel her on stage. And we would have a testimony together, a ministry together. I expected that to happen, and I did not doubt. But that didn't happen. Now, a couple of months ago, I went over to Crossroads on a Sunday morning before our worship time, and I went over to Crossroads, and then I zoomed in just in time for our worship. But I went over there because my son was going to preach. And Josh, my older son, has written a book about Jenny's death and talks about Jenny's death a lot. My younger son doesn't. He moved to Decatur. He's with us. But he doesn't talk a lot about it. But that Sunday, I could practically take notes on the things he said because I hadn't heard it from his perspective before, some of the things he shared. And one of the things he said is this: we expected God. We expected God to give Jenny a ministry. And instead, what God has done is he has filled a lot of pulpits with people that tell stories of the hope of the Lord when the lights were turned out for our family, the way the Lord revealed himself through that. There's a lot of people now testifying to faith through what happened in February 2010. Oh, there's so much more I want to say about that, and maybe I will in the days to come. But I just sat there thinking, God, I so expected you to act, but I didn't expect you to act just like that. And don't you know that that's part of what the boys felt in the boat that day? Jesus, we expected you to act, but we didn't expect to get bruises and scars from a boat being thrown around in torment while we waited for you to show up. We didn't expect it quite like that. We didn't expect it quite like that. I want to move. This is me, Beverly Ross. I want to move toward hope when I see him. Hope can sometimes look scary. Hope can call you to do things braver than you ever thought you could do. Do you agree with that? Hope might require you to do something you're like, who, me? I don't think so. We want to move toward him when things get scary. Move toward him when we see him. And that's exactly what Peter, all by himself, did. Peter moved toward Jesus when he saw him. I want to do something really brave and trust hope to hold me. This story is one of our favorite Peter stories. We teach it to children. We act it out. We talk about it. It's in lots of VBSs. But this is an adult story about being really brave and about trusting hope to hold on to us. We want to invite hope into the scary space. Now remember, when they invited him into the boat, the storm was still going down. The storm did not stop. And they invited Jesus in. Jesus, come with us. Get in the boat. And I want to know that hope, I don't even know this rolls off my tongue very well. I want to know that hope is more important than calm. Do you agree with that? I don't know. I have to think about that one a while. As soon as I wrote that one's still chewing in my gut. I want to lean into hope and to want hope more than I want a calm life. I want Jesus more than I want easy. I want to know him. I want the curse to be reversed for me in my life with my physical eyes, with the eyes of my heart. I want to be able to see him. There are bruises from storms. And if I could ask you, if we had a couple hours right here, and I wish we did because I love hearing people's stories, I would love to sit with you and go, tell me about some of your bruises from the storms. Some of us have bruises that have healed. And some of us, it wasn't just bruises, it was open wounds. And so for some of us, it's not just bruises and open wounds. We have deep scars because of where we've been, because of a storm just like this, because just like these boys did. There was some woundings going on, wounds on our heart. But can you picture? I wonder, what all did they talk about? You know, when in Acts, they're waiting for the Holy Spirit to come on them. and they're sitting around the table. Now, gut level truth. What do families do when they're sitting around the table? We tell stories about the family, don't we? My little grandkids, I asked Rick permission to tell a couple of stories, and he wasn't real up on it. Maybe someday he'll approve, or maybe someday I'll forget to ask. But my kids love to get in the car with me, and they love to hear Grampy stories. And it means stories of funny things that Grampy's done. Tell us another Grampy story. Can't you picture the boys around the table going, tell us a Peter story. Tell us, do y'all remember that time? Do y'all remember that time that Jesus was walking on the water? Dude, I remember what your face looked like. Dude, I remember when you just couldn't stop throwing up that night. Spoken by me who had a bad case of vertigo last night, but I couldn't remember when you couldn't stop throwing up. Do you remember what Peter looked like? Do you remember how he was gulping air when Jesus pulled him up? I mean, don't you imagine some of those stories were the ones to be told? Remember what it looked like. Remember what they acted like. Remember what that was like as they waited for the Holy Spirit to invade. Now, 2 weeks ago, I was in Florida. I think everyone should go to Florida in January. But I got to speak at a youth ministers conference there, and I was made to do counseling on the beach. It's my life profession. Someday, I'm going to have counseling on the beach. You know, just feet in the sand. I don't really like to get in the water, but I love to be in the sand, and I like to be close to the water to smell it and to hear it. And there was a woman there who shared with me. Remember last week we talked about the one little word, and these youth minister girls know about the one little word. So I was with a group of them, and we were sitting around. We were talking at a Starbucks there, and they started telling me, hey, guess what my one little word is this year? Guess what mine is? And the girl right next to me, who's going through some unbelievable hard time right now, she said, my one little word for 2017 is through. I said, what does that mean? She said, I don't want to be so obsessed with the end that I forget to walk through. I want to know that Jesus shows up even while I'm walking through. Before I can feel him, before I can even see him, I know he's with me in the through. Man, there's something just that electrified me when she said that. I felt the skin. I felt goosebumps. Isn't that what you want? Is to know that through life's journey, Jesus is with us and he is for us. Now let's look. Let's go over to Matthew 16. And I wonder if this very story was what was on Peter's mind here in Luke 16. Was it because of his bravery in this story that Peter is the first to claim Jesus as the Christ? It says, I'm in verse 13. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? And they replied, well, let me tell you who they say you are. Word on the street is that some say you're John the Baptist, others say Elijah, still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. I picture a pause right here as Jesus says, what about you? What are you saying about me? Who do you think I am? What about you? And Simon Peter answered, I picture him going, ooh, 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 I know. You are the Christ. You are the Son of the living God. And Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah. For this was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter. And on this rock I will build my church. And the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Then he warned his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Christ. Immediately, upon that confession, upon Peter saying, you are him. You are the one we've waited for. You are the living hope. You are him. Then there's a switch where Jesus begins to tell him, now let me tell you what I'm going to do. Here in verse 21, from that time on, Jesus began to explain to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer. Do you think they expected that? I don't. He said, I'm going to go to Jerusalem and I'm going to have to suffer many things at the hands of the elders, the chief priests and the teachers of the law. And then he must be killed and on the third day be raised to life. And Peter took him aside. Jesus, can we talk for just a minute? You know, Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. Never, Lord. That is not going to happen. Never. This shall not happen to you. Now, you got to understand what Peter's doing right here. All of a sudden, Jesus has instilled in these boys a hope, a lowercase h hope, that he was going to overthrow the Roman government. These boys are accustomed to suffering and to living in fear under the government of what they're about to have to do. And Peter's like, no. I will defend you. I will go down. They'll have to get to me before they get to you. I will totally protect you, Jesus, because I love you. That will not happen to you. You will not have to suffer. We're not going to let those Romans do anything to you. But then Jesus turned to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You're a stumbling block to me. You do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of men. Could it be that that was just too much for Peter? Could it be that was so overwhelming? You do not have in mind the things of the Lord, the things of God. The way of Jesus is he has to suffer. The way of us walking on dirt, I picture right here Peter going, how can I lose you? Just as you have instilled story after story after story into him, it wasn't story, it was life. Just as you have infused in me hope, how can I lose you? How can I lose hope? What on earth are you talking about? How can this be true? But the way of hope, sister friends, the way of hope is to shift your focus. The way of hope is a shift of focus. Life must be about him. Life must become about him and about his desire for the world. Let's keep reading in Matthew 16. Let's go down to 28. We'll read a few verses in 17 of a powerful story that Peter's going to talk more about. I tell you the truth. Some of you standing here, you know what? I want to go back up because I stopped reading in 23. Let's go back up to 24. I don't want to leave anything out of the story. Then Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me will find it. What good will it be for a man if he gains the whole world, yet forfeits his soul? Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man is going to come in his Father's glory with his angels, and then he will reward every person according to what he has done. I tell you the truth. Some who are standing here will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. After 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, his three inner guys. He took Peter, James, and John, the brother of James, and led them up on a high mountain by themselves. And there he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as the light. Just then, there appeared before them Moses and Elijah talking with Jesus. And Peter said to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, can you feel him here? Like, I don't want to be Satan again, but I have another idea. I mean, I don't want you to think that I'm doing anything wrong here. But if you wish, I have another idea. I could put up three shelters, one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah. I could show my love for you by building that. I know how to do that. While he was still speaking, do you hear Peter? Just let me do something for you, Lord. But while he was still going, God's like, I'm not through with the light show yet. God says, I'm not through showing off yet. I've got more I want to reveal to you boys. I've got more I want to show you three. While he was still speaking, a bright cloud enveloped them, and a voice from the cloud said, and this, sister friends, is a deep male voice. Now, sometimes when we talk about the Lord speaking into us or speaking to us, people frequently ask me, was that a male voice? I'm like, no, it's really not. It's like a settling in my soul when it happens for me. This was a voice that they heard. This was a voice that said, this is my son whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him. What do you picture? Let's just go over the senses a moment. And the very first one that comes to me is the feeling. I mean, yeah, they heard it. They're looking at the light. I don't know if there was a smell to the light show or not, but can't you picture the ground shaking when the voice of the Lord spoke? Listen to him. Listen to what he's going to tell you. Listen to him. He is the hope of glory. When the disciples heard this, they fell face down to the ground, terrified. But Jesus came and he touched them and he said, get up. Don't be afraid. When they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus. Proof, living proof, that he is the hope of glory. So go with me over very quickly. We just can't even wait. We've got to go to 2 Peter. Look in 2 Peter, and this is Peter after he'd had a season to reflect on this story. In 2 Peter 1, let's start in 15, says, I will make every effort to see that after my departure, you will always be able to remember these things. After I'm gone and after I can't write you any more letters, I want you to remember. We did not follow cleverly invented stories when we told you about the power and the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses to his majesty. For we received honor and glory from God the Father when the voice came to him from the majestic glory, saying, this is my son whom I love. With him I am well pleased. We ourselves heard this voice that came from heaven when we were with him on the sacred mountain. Peter heard the voice, and we're going to see more about that in 1 Peter when we get there in a couple of weeks. And so what I want to encourage you this week as we journey beside each other to stay with Jesus. Stay with Jesus, the living hope, the hope of glory. Stay with Jesus and expect to be changed. We stay with Jesus and expect to see him at work in us and for us, but definitely not the way we expect. And every time Jesus moves, sister friends, it draws us more and more into awe, into worship, into that moment that absolutely takes your breath away. Now, I want to remind you very quickly about awe. Awe is that human emotion. Every other human emotion has a home in our brain. There's certain neurotransmitters that light up with other human emotions, not with awe. Awe attaches itself to any other of the emotions. Awe is that moment that takes your breath away when you can't help but worship, even if it's in silence. Awe is that moment that makes you go, I can't believe it. Awe is that moment. I picture Peter in an awe moment looking up at Jesus to catch him. Awe is that moment when darkness goes off for you, whether sickness, diagnosis, death, loss of a relationship, a divorce, and you're laying on your bathroom floor in darkness. Awe is that moment where you feel Jesus, or you become aware that he's there. Or even if you don't feel him, you believe that he is there, laying with you and singing over you and moving your hair out of your face, being with you and reminding you there's hope. Awe does not happen for us when we're multitasking. Awe is that moment that requires stillness to be experienced. Would you pray with me? Oh, Father, Jesus, Holy Spirit, we love you. We're absolutely crazy about you. We cannot believe the stories in your word, the way you just continue to pour truth and to pour hope and to pour love and to pour faith into us through the stories that happened so long ago. God, would something stir in our own guts? Would something stir deep in our souls? Would something stir in our hearts? Those of us in this room that are desperate tonight for a word of hope, may we have read one. Would you use these stories to remind us of your presence, of your faithfulness, of your hope, capital H hope, that intervenes when our own hopes have been crushed or dashed. God, would you give us the hope that we need to make it through this next week, to make it through this next week. Through, God. Help us to walk through in a way that brings honor to your name. God, thank you for this group of women. I thank you for every set of eyes in this room. I thank you for the people listening online. I ask, Father, that if I've made a mess of anything, that your Holy Spirit would absolutely clean it up. I ask if there's been stuff that I've said hard or if I misspoke, that your Holy Spirit would just clean it, Father. Because my desire is to bring glory and honor to your name and to spotlight you and to spotlight your truth. God, be with us this week and make your presence be known. And even if we're not in a state we can do that, may we just believe it is there. May we believe your presence, that you, Father God, are with us. Through the name of the Lord Jesus, the resurrected one, every woman in this room who agrees with this prayer says, amen, amen. Man, thank you so much for being here. I've loved being with you. I've loved looking at you. I've loved seeing you in the Word. I've loved getting to hear your comments. Thank you for your comments throughout the last week. Let's meet back next week, and we will be in Luke 22. Some other hard verses, but some stuff we got to know about Peter before we get to 1 Peter, where Jesus offers him hope after a season of darkness for Peter. Thank you for being here.